opportunity to present the work we do at EMPA in our laboratory. I work in a small computational group that is led by Daniele Passerone, and this computational group is embedded in an experimental reality that is the laboratory led by Daniele Passerone. One of the core activities of this laboratory, where simulations run in parallel to experiment, is the fabrication of carbon-based one-dimensional nanomaterials starting from molecules up to atomically precise nanoribbons, in this case graphene nanoribbons, up to hopefully demonstrator of devices. In my talk, I will give you a long introduction that also summarizes some of the milestones we achieved in the past in these fields, and then I will move to more recent results on how we can tune the band gap of these graphene nanoribbons. Everything starts from graphene. The high carrier mobilities in graphene makes it appealing for applications in information technologies, if you want to do, for example, feed effect transistor. But there is a problem: graphene does not have a gap. Now the question is, can we open a gap in graphene and then use it for transistors? Of course, yes. The answer is yes. There are several ways to open a gap in graphene. One of these ways is quantum confinement. If we cut graphene in stripes, one-dimensional stripes, that are the so-called nanoribbons, due to quantum confinement, we will have a quantization of the states, and we will have an opening of the gap. Now, there are different ways in which we can cut graphene into nanoribbons. There are two main waves, this red one and this dark one, that create ribbons that are named after the shape of their edges. We have the red is an armchair ribbon, and the black is a zigzag ribbon, and the zigzag ribbons are predicted to host interesting spin-polarized edge states. Now, if we focus on armchair ribbons, their electronic properties can be easily traced down, derived from graphene, and depending on the width, the number of rows of carbon that we have in the ribbon, we can have that in the back structure of the ribbon, we get close or not, or we even hit the Dirac cone of the graphene. And in this way, basically increasing the width of a nanoribbon, the band gap will decrease, and with the superimposed an oscillation due to different families of the nanoribbons. Now, if we want to think about devices that we could fabricate, given the reduced size of these stripes that are just nanometer wide, it's crucial to avoid the defects in the fabrication of these objects. Is it possible to create atomically precise graphene nanoribbons? Yes. So in our laboratory, Roman Fasel and Pascal Ruffieux followed the initial work of Leonard Grill for the surface acid coupling of molecular precursors. And in these directions, our first studies, computational and theoretical, were investigate the aryl-aryl coupling of this class of molecules. In this case, was the formation of a 2D network of graphene with regular holes. And with this study, we basically demonstrated that everything in the coupling of these molecules is driven by the Ullmann coupling on noble metal substrates. Our next step was to study cyclohydrogenation reactions, so how we can go from this molecule that seems like a patch of graphene, but there are missing carbon-carbon bonds, how we can go from this molecule to this patch of graphene, and basically here the formation of internal carbon-carbon bonds and removal of hydrogen atoms that were passivating the carbons, is driven both by van der Waals reactions with the substrate, metal substrate, and by a moderate catalytic activity of the substrate. Now, wrapping up all these ideas, Fasel and Ruffieux succeeded in this picture. So the idea of getting a molecular precursor that has a shape that is cleverly designed and that has anchoring points that are saturated with boron or halogen atoms, when you deposit these atoms on a noble metal substrate, the molecules will self-assemble in polymers, and then increasing the temperature, the cycle of the reaction will start and we will end up with our nanostructures. The first successful example is this one, starting from a dibromo Bn trail molecule. We fabricated a 7 armchair nanoribbon that in this community is kind of the test system for both for theory and for reproducibility of the experiments. And from the simulation point of view, one of the things that we have to do most frequently is compare the scanning probe images that we have from the experiment, STM or non-contact AFM, with simulation. And not always we are so lucky to have images that are so clear, where there is basically nothing to understand from the computational point, but already in these cases, to understand the origin of this feature in STM, simulations are fundamental. After this first result demonstrated by our laboratory, a huge amount of this class of always armchair nanoribbons appeared in the literature from different laboratories, even including precise atomic doping. Here, this work, if I remember well, was by Mike Cromie and Steven Lui, inclusion of boron in 7 armchair nanoribbons, and also armchain nanoribbons with the fancy shapes, chevron shapes, and again with atomic precise doping, nitrogen. This also from our laboratory and also from other laboratories appear. Now the question is, can we, out of these created devices, to some extent, yes, we will see in one slide later. Now, what do we do from the computational point of view? Standard, basically standard DFT calculations. Always keep in mind that these objects are fabricated and characterized on a metallic substrate. So whenever we can, so basically when we simulate reactions, chemical reactions on the substrate, or when we have to compare STM images in the experiment and the simulation, or atomic force microscopy images, we do DFT calculation with full substrate, including in DFT, the substrate and the adsorbate. So we can easily reach systems of the size of 2,000 atoms. Now, in the case of atomic force microscopy, on top of this, we use an empirical model that mimics the tip of the cantilever of the AFM to which is attached the CO molecule is modeled with a simple empirical model. That works pretty well in many cases. When you have to go to beyond DFT, like for example GW, where we will have to we cannot include the substrate, and the only thing we can do is, as was also discussed yesterday by Jan Willem, include image charge correction to our GW calculation that are done in gas phase. Now, if we focus, as I said, on arsenic nanoribbons, everything works smoothly. Everything is simple, and simple calculation match very well experiments. Now, in this case, for example, we have the 7 armchair that is predicted in theory by GW to have a band gap of 3.7 electron volt. If we take these ribbons and we go along the axis of this ribbon with a scanning tunneling microscope and we do spectroscopy, then we can find in the experiment the onset of electron removal and the onset of electron addition. And if we compare this experimental value of 2.4 electron volt with GW calculations of the ribbon, we see that we have a reasonable agreement when to the GW result we add the image charge correction. In this case, the work was a nice collaboration with Andrea Ferretti and the group of Elisa Molinari in Modena. We can do even more with experiment. If I record the spectrum, the energy density along the ribbon axis, I obtain this kind of plot for occupied and unoccupied states. If I do the Fourier transform, I have access to the band structure of let's call it band structure of the ribbon, but these are finite objects. And from these, I can retrieve the, for example, the effective mass of the electrons on the band. And these come out to be very close to the theoretical prediction. One has just to be a little bit careful. Doing the same experiment in theory, you can demonstrate that if you are not careful doing the experiment, so if the tip of the STM is not enough close to the substrate, you will miss some bands, and this can be dangerous. It was a little bit puzzling. I forgot to start this. It was a little bit puzzling to solve a problem that arises in ARPES measurements. When we did for this ribbon also ARPES measurements for ribbons that are perfectly parallel one each other because are grown on a stepped gold surface, we got that the effective mass from the ARPES and the effective mass from DFT was very off. There was no agreement. It took some years before in the literature it appeared the explanation for this disagreement. And basically, if you are not careful at which k perpendicular you are doing your ARPES experiment, you are missing the top valence band, or you are erroneously assigning the top of the valence bands, as we did, to a band that is not the top band, but is the second one. Now, the only thing I can add on top of armchair nanoribbons is that indeed, if we stay at the level of academic application, so just a user effort to create demonstrator devices, it is possible to transfer these ribbons from the metallic substrate to insulating substrate and contact them and create a device. And they do not perform bad, they are close to, so 10 to the 6 would be an ideal on-off ratio and currents bigger than 1 microamp. Of course, what has to be improved is the device yield. So one would need 90% of yield. We have 10% of success here. And of course, one should find a way to get better aligned ribbons and longer ribbons to really start having something more interesting from the device point of view. Now, let's switch to a slightly different kind of ribbons, so zigzag nanoribbons. As I said, the success in fabricating armchair ribbons comes from the fact that we basically have created them via aryl-aryl coupling that works through the Ullmann coupling. If we want to fabricate zigzag nanoribbons, we should have a different kind of coupling, this kind of orthofusion, that doesn't work well. It's difficult to obtain. Now, our experimentalists, rather than pushing in this direction, said, why don't we play a lot with the shape of the molecules? We have excellent synthesis chemists. Let's try to imagine fancy molecules that then on the substrate maybe will alternate and bind in this fashion. And if we increase the complexity of our precursor molecule, we can close this pattern, and finally, here there would be a CH3, end up with a zigzag ribbon. I would have never believed it. Believe it or not, it works, and it works pretty well. This is the quality of the ribbons that you can obtain. Now, again, apparently, you have a very good agreement between calculations and experiment, but these ribbons are more reactive. And in reality, there are things that are not so well in agreement. Now, let's have a look here. Here is the density of states measured with the scanning tunneling spectroscopy is in perfect agreement with the density of state that we obtained from GW. This was Berkeley GW calculations, basically the same that also Stephen Louis did. And the agreement is a little bit too good, should not be so good. How is obtained the experiment, this red line? This red line is measured on a portion of a ribbon that was dragged on top of a sodium chloride island to decouple the ribbon from the substrate. Now, I say that this agreement is too good because in principle, if the GW would be perfect, still there should be some screening from the substrate, so there's something not perfectly well here. There is another aspect that I don't show you here, that is we wanted to demonstrate that in zigzag ribbons we really have these edge states, and we have them if we measure on the sodium chloride, but if we look for these edge states on the portion of the ribbons that are on gold, despite DFT predicts that these edge states will survive on gold, in experiment you don't find them. Okay, that's all I wanted to tell you about this standard armchair and zigzag ribbon. Now I move to a different way of tuning the electronic properties of this ribbon, basically not drastically changing the shape, but slightly modifying it. Everything started by, this is work of, done by Oliver Gröning. He was digging in our AIDA database of nanoribbons. I forgot to mention that all we do from the computational point of view now for this ribbon is embedded in AIDA workflows as that were described before by Nicola. Now, digging in our database of ribbons and digging in the literature, Oliver found that Stephen Louis explained that if you have a particular junction between a 7-arm chain and a 9-arm chain nanoribbon, you can expect to have a topologically protected state at the interface. If you have two junctions, you can expect two states. And if you play with the distance between these two junctions, you can see that you can have a wide splitting of these two states up to merging them, and then the ribbon basically become a 9-arm chain nanoribbon. If you have many junctions, then you have bands. Now, what Oliver did was considering these bands, considering a possible nanoribbon and saying, basically, I kind of have a state at each side of this functionalization of my ribbon. And he was thinking about the SSH model and basically said, well, this is nothing but the SSH model. Should work like this. And then, just at a tight binding level, he did all the homework of trying to vary the width and the position of these defects. Now, this case is just for the width n equal 1. And you can see that according to the SSH model, you move from a topological insulator to trivial insulator according to the position of these functionalizing groups. Now, this is very nice, especially because these ribbons can be fabricated in reality in our laboratory. And here again, the tight binding bands, you see that on top, in the middle of what would be the bands of the 7-arm chair bone, you see the SSH bands. In the experiment, you see the quality of the ribbon created. You see traces of these states that originate the SSH chain. And can we, from the experimental point of view, find out whether these ribbons are topologically insulated or not? Well, the only thing we can check is if we have an end state. And then if, well, I forgot to mention, you can also see that in the experiment, you can detect the width of this valence SSH band and the width of the conduction band. And if you are looking for states, the measured scanning tunneling spectroscopy images match pretty well the simple tight binding images, and there is no evidence of states at the termini of these structures. Meaning that from this point of view, this is not a topological insulator in agreement with what was predicted by this table, that this class of ribbon would have not been a topological insulator. Now, if we, instead of this class of staggered modification, we considered the inverse modification from the tight binding analysis, this should be a topological insulator, and indeed, if you do the experiment, you find the states at the end of the ribbon. How much time do I still have? I just skipped this, despite this is our first demonstration of a full carbon-based device. It's a nanoribbons on top of graphene leads. We are now measuring, the experimentalists are measuring this, and we will characterize this in a collaboration with Mathieu Louisier, Nicola already mentioned it. Also, this is within the NCCR Marvel. Let me skip this because I want to move to a different idea, that is another way we have, another thing we can play with to tune with atomic precision the properties of these nanostructures is to introduce 4, 5, and 7-membered carbon rings in our structures. The first attempt we did with this respect was creating this kind of analogous of peritetracene molecules. In this case, we have something close to a stone wheels defect. In this kind of works, what is fundamental to understand what you really have on the substrate, because here atomic force microscopy images do not help us very well. To really prove that we have this kind of structure, we need a tight comparison between simulated microscopy and spectroscopy images with respect to the measured ones. I will not enter the details of this, just another example of a molecule that was synthesized and characterized both in theory and in calculation, where you have basically an inverse stone thrower wedge defects in a buckyball molecule with embedded nitrogen atoms. I want instead to spend a few words, and just cut me when I have to stop, and I stop, on perfect. On these other systems, basically in denofluorane, that are the anti-aromatic analogous of pentasine. These molecules have resonance structures where you form a radical and kill the aromaticity, well, the trying to kill the anti-aromaticity of the full molecule. And they are interesting from the experimental point of view because they can exhibit open shell character. They have a small gap. They are very reactive, making it difficult to fabricate them. They are usually fabricated in solution with protection groups. And they have strong absorption in the visible spectrum. These molecules is predicted to have negligible big radical character. This is predicted to have high radical character. This one was already fabricated on surface in solution, and we also created a polymer with this pattern of indenofluorine. And now I just focus on this one. And what I want to say, starting with this precursor, we were able to create at annealing up to a given temperature a chain of these polymers where we have the pentagons that have that are doubly hydrogenated. And here, to understand what we have in the experiment, really, you have to carefully compare atomic force microscopy simulation with the experiment. And here, you undoubtedly see that you have two hydrogens in the comparison with the experiment. Now, here, things do not work as well as was before. If we do the STS assignment of the gap, and we compare it with GW with image charge, the agreement is definitely not good. And this probably is due to the fact that these systems now are interacting with the substance. They are not as the armchain algorithms we had before that are basically physics orbit. If we increase the temperature, we obtain this kind of polymer. It was for us a nightmare to understand what was going on here. And here again, a lot of comparison with simulated atomic force microscopy images and simulated spectroscopy images. So here, for sure, we don't have two hydrogens. Here, there remained only one hydrogen. So this is really an indenofluorine unit. What's going on here? In the beginning, we thought that an additional hydrogen went away. But if you do an anti-elastic band calculation, you see that to remove one hydrogen, it's cost an energy that is comparable with the temperature, but to remove the second hydrogen is impossible. In the end, we found out that this is just a tilting of the segments. When they can match a gold atom substrate, they tilt to partially bind to the substrate. Also, in this case, the matching between GW plus image charge and the measured scanning tunneling spectroscopy onset of valence band and the conduction band do not match. Now, there is a puzzle here that before obtaining these chains of indenofluorine, at a lower temperature, in reality, we obtain these ribbons that are the orthofusions of chains. And for us, it's still a puzzle to understand how this can happen and how magically GW and the experiment match again, because this is less interactive. We think we cannot demonstrate it. We suppose that it's due to the, again, reduced interaction with the substrate. And it was a puzzle because whatever mechanism we try to compute to understand how this form at an energy that is lower to the one needed to form the single hydrogen chain, this is not possible. So from our reaction calculation, we should have first the single hydrogenated chains. What we suppose is that to get this, we have trapped gold atoms that then catalyze the reaction and that for some reason become relevant when forming this change. It's something that we are still investigating. Let me conclude. I skip the conclusions. It's basically just a summary of what I said. I want to stress that this work is, of course, a huge experimental effort, and I cannot thank everybody. It's really plenty of people, excellent PhD students and postdocs in different experimental groups that did all the work. I want to say that from the computational point of view, this would have not been possible without excellent PhD students in the group of Daniele Passerone. We started with Manton Nguyen, that is coming from ICTP. He was at ICTP before joining us at EMPA. And then Leopold Talitz and Sasha Jakutovic, that are now in part with Nicola at Lausanne and in part with Bernd Schmidt in Sion. And now I have Christian Eimre that just started the PhD with me. Thank you very much for listening.